Welcome to GearBox Gallery. My name is Jamie Tracy. I'm a member along with Gina. Just a few sentences about GearBox. This is a very special gallery, all run by artists. We divide up the curatorial work, the exhibitions work, and the PR work together. And then we also have a rotating schedule of featured artists and many guest artists as well. So I want to just read you a little bit about the two artists that we'll be hearing from in the beginning, and then also our third artist that we'll be hearing from during question and answer. So GearBox Gallery is pleased to present Unplanned Landscapes, an art exhibition featuring the work by artists Gina Gaiser and Sarah Newton, who both curiously document transitional places and the effects of humans and climate on the environment. Gina Gaiser is an Oakland artist working primarily in photography and digital media. In high school, she was the first female student to work in the print shop, duplicating print school district forms. There is where she found her love of print processes, paper, and the smell of ink. She received a BA in studio art from the University of California, Santa Cruz, and earned a certificate in printmaking and art history from Il Visconti School of Graphic Arts in Florence, Italy. Upon her return to the Bay Area, she co-founded the artist collective Ben Dunn Presents, producing pop-up art events, and later received an MFA from Mills College in digital media, video, and sculpture. Sarah Newton is a San Francisco artist who works primarily on paper in a variety of media, including drawing, etching, and woodblock printmaking. In her work, Sarah often focuses on spaces and details of the everyday built environment that generally exists at the periphery of attention, like freeway rest areas and transit stations. Sarah has been a featured artist of the San Francisco Center for the Books Roadwork Printmaking event and was invited to create an artist book, That's It, Liquor, Beer, Wine, published by SFCB's Imprint Publications. And in 2014 and 2016, was awarded fellowship residencies at Playa Artist Residency Program in Oregon. She has a degree in printmaking from California College of the Arts. Also here today is Dana DeKalb. She is the GearBox Award winner from our last jury show, Hierarchy. And her work is featured in the Inner Room show, Open Season. Her paintings depict a variety of characters purposefully engaged in a range of joint efforts. Posed diorama-like, the subjects appear to busy themselves with hunting and gathering forays while encountering unforeseen or miraculous events. Although they are challenged and awed, the subjects seem not to have let it dim their enthusiasm for the task at hand. These works can be read as a metaphor for the ways in which we manage the uncertainty and constant change in our own lives. The narratives reflect on our most recent journey together through the 2 years of the pandemic, environmental peril, and political upheaval, as well as our individual endeavors to navigate the world. All right, I turn it over to the artists.
Sarah and I have both prepared a few things to say about our work and some questions for each other that we would like to go through, and then after that we'd like to open up for questions or dialogue with you guys. So, and also include Dana at that point too, if anyone would like to talk to her about her work or maybe anything more. So I guess I'll get started. I'm just going to talk a little bit about my photographs. So this work consists of aerial photographs that were taken from a plane window, looking down on a metropolitan and suburban area. The views allow us to see the fabricated landscapes from above. And after printing them, I wondered what the photos would look like without the housing developments. So I cut them out by hand with an X-Acto knife. And the white space in the photos is what's missing. So it's mostly housing, parking lots, some retail spaces. And it references the inaccessibility for many people to own a home and be part of that community. The small objects on the pedestals here are also cutout photographs that I reassembled to make geometric shapes.
Thank you. So my work has ink blotch drawings, and these drawings are an exploration of the proposed Bosco Bay Trail. They've been following the shoreline using the map of the discontinuous segments of the trail. And so I find the endpoints of the trail where it hits restricted areas or industry, zones of construction, and see what's there. So I feel like just looking at the map itself can tell you one story about a possible future of the bay, but actually going and walking those places and seeing what's there provides more intimate familiarity with the changing margin between the land and the water and our communities. This is the first time I've had an opportunity to get to know Gina and her work, so I really appreciated having that chance. And the first thing that we had to do together was come up with a title for the show. So we decided on Unplanned Landscapes as something that spoke to both of us about our work. It was interesting to me because very little of the bay shoreline is unimproved in one way or another. It's all been planned, and in walking, I see the layers of the history of that planning. I see how plans have changed and how that represents changing philosophies about the use of the bay as a utility, as a natural resource, as an industrial resource. And not just the history, but from community to community. So if I walk to a place like Foster City, for example, where it's been very developed with these canals and the bays, as a real estate resource, as a recreational resource, but not a natural one, and comparing that with some place like the landscape in this drawing, which is down in the South Bay, that's in where the Parkdale used to have some of the salt ponds, and that's a wetlands restoration area. So that's a really different way of thinking about our relationship to where we live. Even now, like in Redwood City, the salt ponds there aren't being used by Cargill anymore, but just recently they hoped to develop those, fill them in and build on that right to the water's edge, rather than do something like wetlands restoration. And so it shows that that conflict in many philosophies is still really ongoing. And some of those unplanned plans that never came to fruit are interesting too. At one point in the 50s, there was a plan to fill in most of the bay. They were going to put a dam where the Bay Bridge is now, and a dam where the Richmond Severn Fell is now. Fill in all of the shoreline of Oakland, like 20,000 acres of land would be filled, and we'd have two freshwater lakes, and the bay would just be that little part by the Golden Gate, because it just wasn't seen as having any value. So they built the bay model in Sausalito to test that. Actually, the Army Corps of Engineers, if you've ever been there, it's a scale model of the San Francisco Bay, and it turned out to be unfeasible. So that's a plan that was suddenly unplanned. But also the fact that we can't really plan for what's to come. It's been about 30 years that the Bay Trail has been under construction after planning, and at that time, climate change and sea level rise, the conversation was different than it is now, and that ever-shortening horizon of consequential sea level rise makes it now very difficult to look 30 more years into the future and make a plan. So to me, the Bay Trail also represents that too, as like a vision for the future of the bay that now is facing transitions. So that's how I felt about the title, but I'm not sure how you felt it related to your work.
Yeah, it was interesting in our first conversations together just how similar we think about the way we make work, but our work looks very different. So the process has been really fun to talk about with Sarah. My work's always looked at landscape and how it's changed since humans have been on Earth, so things that humans have built in the space that we occupy. And I've been thinking about what kinds of structures we build and then, you know, where, how they're used. The planned communities in these photographs stood out to me because they took up so much space and they didn't follow any sort of natural landscape lines. And then, of course, the transportation, the freeways and the roads seemed to also mark how the land was being used as well. And then during the pandemic, I was really struck by how our spaces no longer fit our needs. So there were so many office buildings that were sitting empty because people were working at home because of the social distancing orders. And then there were people without homes who were living out in the streets and under freeways and in parking lots and such. I was looking for a way to document both that permanent landscape, those buildings and then the freeways and such, and also the temporal changes that were happening with people, you know, being out and about or didn't have a place to go. So I'm really interested in, you know, how we use what we have and then also highlight what's missing. So I wanted to talk about the titles. For me, the titles ended up being the locations of where I was over the landscape. So all of these were done on two separate trips that I took in the last year on airplane. And I took them with my iPhone, which actually recorded the area below me while I was in flight. So when I got home, I was able to look them up on Google Maps and look at the street view and the terrain view and sort of figure out where and how the satellite image looks compared to my photo. So what I did is I took that URL and made a QR code here on each of the titles. So if you use that on your phone, you can actually go to that Google map and then see what that area looks like from the satellite and also plug in what's missing.
But these are your pictures.
Yes, thank you. So I took these pictures, myself from the plane, but the Google images are the ones that I'm here. So, let's see. So how does the show title relate to your work, Sarah?
I'll just go with the talking about the QR codes, which I borrowed from you because I thought those were really cool. And I also go and choose these places from a map, but I have no idea what they're going to look like because the QR codes are taking you to Google Maps because the map I use is the online version of the Bay Trail map, but you don't have the ability to drop a pin on there and save a location to share. But anyone can look at it after the talk. But there's solid sections and then there's dotted sections that are planned. And so what I do is I pick those points of transition and try to figure out how to go there. The endpoints are sometimes really abrupt and sometimes they're really hard to find. And they're often not in places where pedestrians usually go, so they're sometimes really hard to get to on public transit or on foot, which is how I get around. So they might be like a freeway on-ramp or at the edge of the landfill, at the edge of the airport, something like that. And as much as I appreciate the whole project of the Bay Trail and the way it's made the Bay into something for people to learn about and enjoy and appreciate as a kind of resource, I haven't really walked on the Bay Trail itself very much because I usually try and follow those uncompleted sections as closely as I can to where they are on the proposed map and just see what's there, what's in the way, what's happening, and I always find things that make me wonder about them. Like there's the Millbrae tidal gate in the drawing around the corner, or a section of the coastline at Burlingame where the whole shoreline has been hardened with these huge blocks of concrete that are obviously from the demolition of something, and wondering what that is. The remnants of an old bridge down near the Dumbarton Bridge, which turned out to be the first bridge across the bay, but all that's left of it now is mostly a series of burned stumps. So I always find things and learn about the history of the bay and its changing role in the environment and the communities here. And the farther I got from San Francisco, it's become more and more complicated to get to the Bay Trail segments because I used to just hop on the bus or Caltrain and then it wasn't very far, and now it's like Caltrain to BTA to like maybe a little shuttle that takes you out to an industrial park at the Bay side that only runs on weekdays. So it's become a real transportation planning adventure, and I enjoy that kind of travel. Well, I had to take a break from just during the pandemic because a lot of the transit was shut down, but I like that slow way of traveling through the landscape. I like that I don't necessarily have control over the route. I don't know where I'm going. I haven't seen these places before I get there. And it's a different perspective on the landscape. And, well, it's a really different perspective on the landscape than your photographs. But they're also about transportation in a way, in traveling through the landscape. And how do those ideas relate to the work you're doing?
Yeah, so that was a similarity between us. Before the pandemic, I worked in the city and I had to take my kids to school. So I'd have to go east to out to Arima Canyon and then go all the way to the city, like as a one-way trip. So I spent a lot of time actually making art on my commute as well. I would take photographs, I would find different ways to get to work and get my kids. And actually really enjoyed my last commute, which was the ferry ride, which was one of the three legs of the trip. So I was also seeing like the landscape and the bay from the water versus from driving on the bridge or other spaces. And it was also a way for me to kind of document my everyday activities and mark time and connect with people, right? So I was sort of documenting getting to work, I was documenting coming home and seeing people that I cared about and things that I cared about. So I generally create photographs that document moments that we might not otherwise notice or remember. And I also thought about how you can feel emotionally close to people that you're not physically close to, and vice versa. Like sometimes you can't, you're in a room with people but you don't feel close to them. So it's always been sort of this emotional metaphor as well to me, like getting somewhere to see somebody or coming back. So once I stopped commuting, actually I just added this morning, so that's actually when I started doing a lot more artwork, because I realized I had 3 or 4 extra hours of my day not commuting, so I'm still working at home, and that's given me an opportunity to do something with my photographs and print things and apply for shows and be part of GearBox. So actually that's been a really cool gift for me. And then in general, my process has been taking photos with an iPhone or my camera or a camcorder, and then bringing them into the computer and doing a lot of work in Photoshop or Lightroom or other kinds of photo software. So even though these were 2 separate trips, the landscapes of the original photos were actually very different. In California, there was a lot of blues and greens from the natural landscape, and then in the desert, this was actually quite brown. So I wanted to come up with filters digitally that sort of tie all the work together. And I found this sort of a combination of filters, but this blue and sort of almost pink undertone filter that I felt worked with all of the images. So it sort of boosted up the roads and some of the contrast of some of the elements that I wanted to enhance. And I also thought it referenced like blueprints, like in urban planning documents. So I kind of like that aspect as well. So once I printed them and enlarged them, I was really struck kind of by the patterns of the houses. And I also was really thinking that, like, I started looking at a lot of aerial photography and looking at where they were to make my titles. And I felt like my photos kind of, they were an aerial photo, you know? Have been a satellite, eventually Google took, and it could have been mine. I didn't feel like there was anything that was particularly spoke to me in my work. I mean, it was just this random photo I kind of took from an airplane looking down at this place that I haven't been to physically. So I think that's what sort of spurred me to think about these photos in a different way and try to make them a little bit more my own. And when I started looking at the patterns and just the images, it was really fun to start thinking about how I could layer things or play around with that further. Now, I had carpal tunnel surgery last year, both my hands kind of staggered. So while I was working on these pieces, I actually couldn't work on the computer more than like an hour a day. So even though I wanted to work on them more, I decided that actually cutting into them would be an option. So I found this little X-Acto knife finger blade. It goes around my finger that I had to put my finger. So that's actually how the cutting of the images kind of came out. And it was also nice for me because I used to do a lot of collage and painting and printmaking, but I haven't in quite a number of years. So it's kind of a nice way to do photography, but do it in a different way. Similarly with the little sculptures, I was cutting things out and then recreating them, taking them apart and putting them back together. So I know, Sarah, you use photography also in your work. So why don't you take photos of the locations? Do you want to talk a little bit about how photos are your process?
Yeah, it is. People often say to me, oh, it looks just like a photograph, which I hope it doesn't, actually. You know, I can, it's meant as a compliment. But they are drawn from photographs, and yeah, it takes a really long time to get to these places. It also takes a really long time to see them. I spend a lot of time in the landscape just walking and looking around, but to take a photograph of me takes a second. And so by recreating them, I do a little bit of sketching on site in pencil sometimes, if it's not something that you show later. I'm hoping to bring back some of that sense of time and duration and careful consideration into the work so that, like, clearly there's something more to it than the photographic source. There's a reason to take this place, which is kind of a non-place, and take that time and care to recreate it in the studio. And oftentimes I work from four or five different photographs, so they're composite things together. I often do small studies, which I brought some up. because they're in gouache, it's a little unforgiving once you started. So, this is the study that I ended up using from this place, but I spend a lot of time there. This is the same place from a different point of view that I did another small study of and ended up using this one. I think I liked it because the Oakland calls me. But anyway, in that process, I also spend a lot of time trying to decide what to include and what to leave out. Like the way the edges sort of drift off and leave some space for something else, maybe a sense of memory or potential, possible sense of loss. Like the way you have something, memory in your mind, it's not completely clear. It sort of fades out the edges. So in that way, I hope to bring that sense of time into them because they are capturing a moment, but the places themselves are transitory and they're never be exactly the same way again, even if I go back to draw it again the next day. So.
I have a comment.
Okay.
So both of you, it's really interesting. Yours look like postcards to me. Some kind of a strange tourist destiny. But both of you, they feel very lonely. And I'm wondering if that's on purpose or is it just that you're focusing on something else? But, you know, both of you actually see these sort of, the leftovers of human civilizations, old warehouse in the distance, or, a lot of these seem like industrial sites or parking lots, but not an indication of a vibrant human
show up. Actually, when I wasn't doing this, I got a chance to go down into the Muni tunnels on a tour with some transit people. They weren't running any trains, and I took a lot of pictures, and since my work doesn't usually have a lot of figures in it, I tried to take a lot of pictures without people, but then when I started drawing from it, I started putting more and more people into the drawing, and it's the only time I really felt like a connection with figures in my work.
So were these done before the pandemic?
For the most part, the newest ones, these two are relatively new, and the two over there are from afterwards. But I just wasn't using transit, except I had to go to work.
So that put a damper on the piece.
Yeah, and a lot of things weren't running. But also, because these are often industrial areas, if I do see people, they might be off in the distance, like loading a truck or something like that. But there, I don't photograph the parts of the Bay Trail that are recreational and draw those where you might see people walking right by.
It's definitely a real feeling.
Yeah, I think there's actually some intentionality for me around that. That I think there's a lot of discomfort in trying to document some of these things on the ground. I mean, honestly, like just down the street. I thought, okay, I'm in GearBox, I can use this as an opportunity to do something for the community here, and maybe do something with this one encampment that's like steps away. Oh, you can hear. Okay, so I was gonna say it's been a struggle to figure out how to do work like that and respect people's privacy and show kind of a hopeful solution-based work, which or something even kind of beautiful, which I often kind of think is the end goal for something stands on its own. So I think it's been easier to sort of look at the effects of people, and especially, I mean, this is the farthest away I've gotten, literally an airplane looking down. But I mean, I do have photos of the people in them. But I also recognize I don't have a background in like journalism, you know, which would be kind of like going down to a place and doing interviews and telling people stories. It might be something that I might want to try, you know, eventually, or partner with somebody else and try. But yeah, I agree with you. Even though there aren't people, I think that it's very much about people.
Right.
And emotions for me.
It just feels so lonely. Not necessarily a bad way.
Yeah.
Just quiet.
Yes. You mentioned that part of your process is that you have to edit things out mm-hmm. and decide what you're going to include and what you're not going to include in your drawings. Mm-hmm. And it got me curious because I understand your drawings as mapping, you know, and in the mapping process, that decision process is always part of it. You know, when you include it, any map, road maps, whatever, there's always that editing process. And I'd like to hear you talk about what are you thinking about when you decide to not include. Is it systematic? Do you say, okay, on this one, I'm not going to include the scene. So, you know, as a general, like, you know, as you would do in mapping.
Right.
Including this.
No,
or is it just here or there? Or like, what's your
it's
process?
Not compositional, really, like making decisions. Like with this one, you know, the decision of whether to be looking this way, which this would basically be right there, or to be looking this way, and you know, how did the compositions work when I have painted them out? Sometimes with photography, too, like, I feel like the photograph was enough. If I feel like I took a picture of something because it's a thing, then I don't feel like I need to draw it. Like this is one I did a little study of. And I took a picture of it because I thought it was funny. It's this sidewalk and it has the walking and biking symbol and the walking and biking symbol and then like a big stanchion where you can't walk or bike, you know, and I drew it, but then I made the little study, and I thought, well, that's not really something you need to think about. It's just, you know, it's amusing, but they're not about things, they're about capturing the feeling of being in that place. So So if it ends up being too much about a thing, then it doesn't make the cut. Or what else? Oh, there's the tidal gate. I also have here. And this is another one where I did two different views.
That's the one.
Yeah, the one around the corner of the same place. And you guys can look at these if you answer all relatively quickly.
Yeah, I was interested, I really responded to Sarah when you're talking about the changing margin of the water and the land. And I was wondering, for both of you, what have you noticed about how the bay's infrastructure and that changing margin either allows or repels people from entering the water and, you know, our interaction with the water, rather than just being pedestrians around the bay, but also access to the water?
It's an interesting thing, some of your pictures, which I think are places I've been, but not seen from that view at all.
Yeah, the color ones there are in Hayward, so coming into the airport, which is still from a plane, but much closer. It was just interesting, we were talking before the talk and realized that we had both gone out to take photographs of king tides this last month or two. I mean, you guys know what those are. So it's a phenomenon where the bay water rises quite a bit, I think at least a foot or two. And then places that are close to a shoreline, you know, can be quite dangerous actually to be on, or at least get flooded. And again, I think it's kind of like, for me, it's like things are built. And often for us, a lot of the places that I was going on my commute or was taking pictures from were actually the scenic tourist spots, right? Like you're standing on the Embarcadero by the ferry building in San Francisco looking at the paper that you're looking at Angel Island. And yet the king tide's there and you actually can't get there, right? Like nature's still coming in and gonna do its thing, even though we built this really beautiful deck for people to like look out of this view. So I don't know what to say about it per se. I guess it's just also, it's interesting to me that the play between nature and then what we've built around nature to sort of ship, kind of try to contain it.
Yeah. Well, this to me feels, looks flooded too. Because what those white parts, which almost looks like a vision of the
future. That's interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I
didn't question about your observations or encounters with non-human life in these landscapes. So, you know, considering that you're alone without people in these places that feel kind of desolate, if you just your experiences of non-human animal life and whether or not they figure into how you think about it or just.
I'm just
curious about that. Do you see much or?
A lot of them. No, you know, most of them are. Semi-urban, except for these wetland reclamation project areas, which then have a lot of waterfowl. Right. So I see the normal semi-urban coyotes and raccoons and things that are relatively shy. I don't mind trespassing usually, but if I see something where it's burrowing owl habitat or their red-sided garter snake or something like that, then I don't trespass because I'm not trying to make a disturbance out of myself. But there's not a whole lot of wildlife that I've come across. And as far as the people's interaction with the bay that Jamie was, I think people always find interesting ways to use the landscape, whether it's designed for it or not, like the place in Burlingame that I was talking about, the big slabs of concrete being the shoreline, is pretty uninviting, but apparently it's great for fishing because there are tons of people there fishing off of these slabs of concrete that sort of jut out into the water at strange angles. So that's interesting too to me, is the way that people find new uses for things that weren't intended for them. Yeah.
Sarah, how did you pick the paper colors? Because it looks like the built environment is more gray and then the more natural is the sepia. Has there a reason you picked them?
I think it has more to do with the light.
The light?
Yeah. Sometimes the colder, bright sunlight tends to lead me towards the gray paper, and then these warm, muddy, cloudy places lead me more towards the brown.
Have you been to the Albany Bowl yet? Have you been to the Albany Bowl? I was thinking of you're talking about all of this detritus of humans in the bay, and the bowl is an old landfill full of it.
Yeah, I have been like just as a visit, not on my trip, which started in San Francisco. I went south down the peninsula, and now I have just worked my way around Alameda, the closed point tip of Alameda, and then in the last places I went, these were out by the Oakland airport, this one. So, but I'm not sure we can look at the map, but I think the Bay Trail through that part of the East Bay might be pretty much completed, so I probably won't be visiting it as
part
of
this. It is now. It wasn't. It just recently finished.
Yeah.
I guess it's for Gina, just sort of look moving forward, like these were obviously taken on commercial flights that you were on for another purpose. Like moving forward, will you continue to, you know, get a window seat on whatever side? but have you looked into other ways of getting access to this kind of aerial thing that you've been doing?
Yeah, that's funny you said that, because my friend Michelle is here, who I met in sixth grade. She's one of my best friends ever. And she's a pilot, another four-seater, and then it's awesome. Yeah, and actually, Sebastian, my son over here, and her have been, we've flown together, but not recently for this project. And we were actually talking a little bit about it when I was making these, because I'd already collected these photos when I decided to kind of use this as material for the show. But yeah, yes to that. And then also, I did buy a drone over the pandemic, thinking that might be a nice hobby to do while I was at home and in different areas. So I'm sort of learning that, which is kind of complicated, actually. In a lot of the places that I wanted to go to, I couldn't fly the drone, and I'm also not very good at it. So a couple of crash landings, I realized I needed some more practice. But it was interesting because I think my thought of the drone, I was going to be able to get quite a bit of, you know, like if I did an expo freeway, like maybe I could see some of these, like, you know, encampments or something like that and get a picture of the landscape. But you actually have to go up pretty high to get, not even as detailed as this, but it was still pretty close. And again, I didn't want to, you know, infringe on people's privacy or, you know, create an accident on the freeway or anything like that. So it's a thing I'm playing with.
Gina, those two photos, the top left and the bottom right, they're very similar. Is there a reason? Like, is it compositional, or are they saying different things for you?
Yeah, actually, a lot of these kind of connect. Like this, this park is the same park, actually. So, you know, we were going over this area slow to do a landing. So I was we were over the same area for a while. So I had taken a lot of photos. And then when I decided which ones to use to cut and to do different things with, I was sort of gravitating towards ones with the housing developments. So I have more, but they were about landscapes that I just didn't think were always interesting. I wasn't actually planning on having all of these in the show, but it ended up working out nicely to have the groupings, and that was actually kind of an afterthought. So I had just sort of created everything separately and then just tried to map it out. Things kind of naturally just went together. But I will say that some of my past work, I also do video, and I'm also really fascinated with, like, my bridge kinds of, you know, photos where it was like slightly different, and I've done some projects in the past where I was doing contact sheets of things changing very ever so slightly over time. So it was kind of an interesting maybe serendipitous thing that it has that kind of quality. I guess I like it, even though it wasn't planned. That's what I'm saying.
Oh, I see that here you included this giant parking lot that would be right there in that image. I was interested when I was looking at them in the opening, the way by reducing so much of it to a pattern, the parts of it that are left just became a pattern for me too, like the parking lot. If all the houses were in, I would look at this landscape with the parking lot, but as it is, then it also just becomes a pattern on a different scale. And
but it also seems to reference the pattern of the houses that aren't there, but we know they're there. And the cars and parking lots. It is all patterns.
Yeah, and it's just a slightly different way of looking at the same place, I guess, too, which is what I was kind of calling on. Thank you guys for your questions. People had a chance to see the interim show. Dana got to our panel, which is awesome.
Does anybody have any questions?
Well, since we were getting into it with these guys, is your source material at all photography based? They have a feel of maybe some photos?
I take some of my own pictures, but I usually source from old textbook. I've got a library of old textbooks, yearbooks, travel guides from the 50s and from all over the place. And I've got, you know, library books. I've got all these folders and clippings. And so I take my, put them together, I flip them, I use different things. So yes, I do work with photos. And then, you know, at some point I throw the photo away and just look on it. So, but I'm interested in juxtapositions and how we relate to each other and how we surprise each other. So this whole show, as you read, as Jamie read, it's about all of us trying to go about our lives and getting stuff thrown in our path and how we deal with that. And these poor people are having some really scary stuff thrown in their path, but they seem to be fine. So I think that it ends on a hopeful note. That's it. They're all acrylic by canvas, lots and lots of layers, glazes. They take a long time to do. And that's about it. I like to work with series, so they're all done around the same time. So that's it.
And is this body of work since the portraits that you had in your box last year?
Are they what?
Sorry. Were they created since the series of portraits that you had last year?
Like I said, I like to work in series, but the series all kind of blend into each other.
Okay.
And, you know, so I think these are all done after that. But the other proto paintings for these sort of have started before that. So, and the pieces that were here last year were part of another series called Despot Housewives, which I did with Jane over there and another artist, the three of us did a project. So they were the nine wives of President Sukarno. And we picked a bunch of dictators and painted all their wives. So the show was called Despot Housewives. So they were part of that group. And then that sort of morphed, you know, into some of these things. I'm very interested in other countries and how I grew up overseas, so that's how we look at other societies and cultures and how they look at us.
That's kind of a timeless quality, or maybe even a quality.
Yeah, I mean, I want them to be metaphors. You know, I want them all to. I think the metaphor has been dropped in our society, and I want to bring it back. So. Yeah, they're really metaphors for how you live your life, and you can bring whatever you want to any of those paintings. You know, then let me know what you come up with.
Thank you. Well, we'll be around to answer more questions.
Thank you.
Thank you guys for coming.